And welcome. Welcome to September's Filling Station. Thank you all for coming. It was going to be very lonely if you hadn't come. So I'm thankful that you're here. Good to see you. Welcome. When we were praying earlier, I got the real sense God was saying, what do you need? Now, I'm not the name it and claim it type. I'm not into that. Not into that at all. But you know what? My God meets all my needs. And that's a promise that he's made to me. So tonight, I'm going to invite you to think about, as we worship and as you listen to Nathan, I knew that. Listen to Nathan. Just consider, what's God wanting to supply to you? And I don't mean make a shopping list, that's not what I'm on about. We all need, we all have needs. At this moment in time, my need is actually a bit of sleep. That would be nice. But I'm here. I'm here to enjoy God's presence. But what are your needs? They will not be the same as mine. I know people who need real healing, and I'm not in that boat. I don't have that urgency. I know people who are in need financially, and that might be through their own fecklessness, or it might be through circumstance that's been thrust upon them. And who am I to judge? But God can meet that need. God can meet all our needs. And he wants to meet our needs. I really felt that earlier on, that God was saying, what is your need? Not what your want is. I don't mean, like, it's not a shopping list. Anyway, I just want to take this moment before we start to thank God that he is our Jireh, God, our provider. And he knows us, and he knows us so well. He knows what will heal us. He knows what will build us up. He also knows what will snare us and tear us down. Only give us those things that we need. So, Father, I thank you tonight for everyone that's here. Father, I thank you for Eric and Elizabeth as they lead us to you in worship. Father, help us to humbly come before your throne. And thank you for Nathan, who's come to share your word, to speak your words of life and truth to us, whatever those might be. Father, I pray your Holy Spirit will move through everything that we do tonight and meet those needs. And Lord, I pray if it needs courage to stand up and recognize that need, I pray for courage. If we need to humble ourselves to recognize that need, Father, help us to humble ourselves before you, that we might receive your love that you've poured out abundantly upon us. Take us to that place, Lord. We honor you as we come. Amen. Eric.
Just shout at me when you want me to stop. Yeah. Comfortable tonight, if you want to stand, if you want to remain seated, if you want to kneel down, if you want to lie down, just be comfortable in God's presence. If this isn't the normal place where you go to worship, Just treat it like you've moved from one room to the other in God's house tonight. Yeah.
Jesus Christ, crucified, bled and died to save our lives. Giver of boundless love, faithful one, to you we run. Every tongue will shout, Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. Every eye will see the coming of the King. Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord.
Coming of the King of Kings.
hear the cry of our heart tonight. Come and be the absolute epicenter of all that we do. Come and be enthroned on our praise and on our worship.
Inside of those lungs, get up and praise the Lord. So
so. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. So get up and praise the Lord.
Great.
pray. Great. Survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. My richest gain I count but loss. made you too small in my eyes. Oh Lord, forgive me, and I have believed in a lie that you were unable to help me. But now, oh Lord, I see my wrong. Heal my heart and show yourself strong. And in my eyes and with my song, oh Lord, be magnified. And there is nothing you can do. Oh Lord, my eyes are on you. Be magnified. Oh Lord, be magnified.
You be magnified.
Amen. Lord, be magnified. Righteous and holy King, be magnified. Father, open our ears to hear you speak. I hear your voice. Gentle whisper. Speak to us, Lord. Welcome to Nathan. He's spoken here before, and we really appreciate the word that you bring, the support that you give us as a group. Please be blessed. Over to you.
All right, can we do like another hour of that? No. How many of you guys were really lost in Jesus for a little bit? First of all, it's just so nice to be with you all again. Just a privilege, and try to adjust this thing. Can you guys hear me all right? Great, great. How many of you are ready for revival? When you say that, yeah, we're all like, yes, yes, we become the greatest cheerleaders on the planet, don't we, for revival. I want to pray for us, and then I just want to go after the Holy Spirit for a little bit, and then what I would love to do is I want to bring a word, which... You ever had those words that you're like, Lord, I don't want to bring that one? You ever had that moment when you're like, I'm sitting there today having this conversation with Jesus saying, Lord, is there any other way? You know, like that Garden of Gethsemane moment, like, is there just another? Like, I could bring something different. But I believe that the Lord, if we're going to press into revival and we're going to press into seeing Scotland change, we need to actually get into a position by which we start to do what the Word of God says. You know, called to practice certain things. And let me tell you something, it's the hardest thing to do in the world is to live up to the words of Jesus, but at the same time live in the grace of Jesus, at the same time walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, at the same time live in a godless world, and yet reflect the light of Jesus. So let's pray. Father, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for your word. I thank you, Father, for the filling station. We want to be filled, Lord, tonight. Lord, we want more of your glory in this land. Lord, we're hungry. And Lord, we need you. Father, help us to understand your word more clearly so that we might apply it to our lives, that we might see this land changed for your glory, and at the same time, that we might be changed ourselves. Lord, we thank you for the worship tonight, Lord. We thank you that we can draw into you, and we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would give us wisdom and revelation into the knowledge of your Son, Jesus. We praise you. We thank you. We honor you tonight in this place, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you're following along in your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn to Romans. We're going to start in Romans chapter 16. And then we're going to kind of make our way over to 1 John. See where God takes us from that point. How many of you are excited about your Bible tonight? Excited about the Word of the Lord? I am, very much so. All right. I found it fascinating. Paul is a unique one in the sense that when he's writing to the Roman church, you can imagine Rome. Rome has about 147 to 50 believers at the time when Paul is writing this letter. That's not many more than us. In a city of millions of people, the greatest city on the planet at that time, and he's writing to the small group of fledgling believers wondering, how do we live out this faith? What do we do, and what kind of practices do we have that is going to actually change the world? And I don't know about you, but it would seem a bit daunting to me to be in the midst of that, getting this letter read to me, And wondering, okay, what do I do? Maybe you're Phoebe, because that's what chapter 16 is saying. You're one of the people in this book, and you're sitting there thinking, he just named me in the letter. How many of you have ever been named before? Some of you are like, yeah, that happened at school once. I didn't like that so much. But the reality is, how many of you have been named? We've named. And this is where he finds himself. And I love this because Paul's about ready to visit Rome. He really longs to come here. He said, hey, I want you to do something. Stop passing judgment on each other. And it got quiet. And then he goes on to say, don't cause each other to stumble at all. Live a life that helps each other to live out this faith. This is chapter 14, and he's moving towards 15. He says there's an example. His name is Jesus Christ in chapter 15. And he says this, he's able to give you endurance because he's the God of endurance and encouragement that you might live a life of harmony. He uses that in Colossians as well, that you might live in harmony. Now, we had this video when we had VHSs. Do you remember those? And we used to put them into our TV, and our little girls were running around, and we had this song, and it went something like this. You got to have harmony. You got to have harmony. And we would dance around in my little house, and my children would be dancing, my little girls, and we'd be talking about harmony. But there's an unlocking of power in a land when we start to work together for the glory of God and His kingdom. And it's in this moment that Paul is starting to say, hey, wait a second. There's something powerful in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, that together you may what? With one voice, glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that's chapter 15. I don't know how exciting we can get 16, but 16 is pretty exciting because he finally comes to the end and he says, I've got all these things to say to you. And he says this, I appeal to you, chapter 16, verse 17, he said, I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out. If there's ever a time in our society, in every generation, we have to watch out for what's being said all around us, don't we? We have to be on guard to some extent to what the prevailing ideologies, the prevailing theologies, the prevailing thoughts and issues. And they're no different in Paul's day to what we're dealing with today. And somehow we think that we're doing something new, maybe. But in reality, no, these are what he's dealing with. And he says this, I want to appeal to you. I'm making a call out to each of you in this room from generation to generation. I'm appealing to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions. He's just cried out for harmony. And he said, no, I want you to watch out for those who cause divisions and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that we taught you. And then he says some strange thing, and if you want to circle it in your Bibles, I don't know if you're following along in your Bibles. That's very imperative, by the way, to know your Bible. And he says this, avoid them. He's not talking about the doctrine. He's talking about those who cause the obstacles. Those who cause the divisions. Now, he said this, I want to appeal to you that you might follow the teachings. There's only one place that we can actually go where we get good doctrine and good teaching. It's the Bible. There's no other book by which we can actually find truth and the source of life than other than the Word of God. And when Paul is talking, he's saying, hey, wait a second. Read the Old Testament, read the Gospels, and read my letters. Listen to what I've taught you. Listen to what I've told you. Listen to what I've written to you. And this is so important for us because in the melee of our society, people are telling you things all the time, aren't they? How many of you hear things? How many of you watch the news? How do you spend more time watching the news than you do reading your Bibles? Uh-oh, no, no, no. Nathan, don't talk like that. But the reality is we do. We tend to take in the world continuously. And what he's saying is, wait a second, there are people in your midst causing division. Avoid them. Now, the divisions is real interesting. He says this, I want, if you were to circle the word divisions and you said, hey, here's what I need for you. I want you to stand apart from them. That's literally what the Greek is meaning. They're over here, you stand over here. If we're going to change the world, we got to look different than the world, don't we? Which means we can't muddle so much with what the world is doing. We have to stand apart from them. The obstacles are traps, right? How many of you ever fell into a trap? And he's saying this, wait a second, there are obstacles, there are stumbling blocks. Remember in chapter 14, he said, hey, don't put a stumbling block in each other's way. If your brother is doing this, don't do this. If you're out to dinner with somebody who's suffering from alcoholism, don't drink a beer in front of them. You know, little things. Don't put the stumbling block in their path. Called to deviate. And literally, it's like a reed being bent over in the wind. Kind of step back. And it's so antithetical to what we normally are taught, aren't we? You need to go out into the world. You need to share the gospel. You need to go and do all these things and meet people and be in the midst of them. And what Paul is saying this, if people are in your life and they're causing division, avoid them. Get away from them. Stand apart from them. Why? Why? Because it's the training of the Old Testament. It's the training of Psalm 1. You don't sit in the seat of what? Offers, yeah. You're called out. The literal Greek word that they're using is ekklino. Get out. Move away. It's come out. We are the ecclesia of God, are we not? Ecclesia literally means the church or the congregation. We're the called out ones. And yet we sit in the middle and often align ourselves with the conversations. Yet God is saying, hey, come out of that. It's no different than the teachings of Jesus. What did he do with his disciples? He took them away from the group, did he not? So that he could train them and grow them and teach them. Why? Because he was training a group of people who would take a kingdom to the world. They would lay down their lives and they would see revival spread throughout the Roman Empire. They'd see their families transformed. Why? Because they were called out. Called out. Now it's interesting, he goes on to say, the way that they do this is they do it by flattery. They do it by smooth talk, and they deceive the hearts of the naive. We live in a world right now in which flattery and smooth talking is quite normative, isn't it? And oftentimes, it's easy to be moved in that way. So messages like this, where we go, we got to step back. We got to be antithetical. We can't just be always out there. And I hear that all the time. And I say it all the time. There's my confession. I'm a minister. Get out there, share the gospel, do this. You know, in my own heart, I'm like, okay, but Lord, you're calling us back so that we can be retooled, retrained. This is what a disciple is, to move out into the world, that when we bring light, we actually bring light. But we look different than the world. I want to ask the question, how do we do that? How do we do that? How do we walk away at times from conversations or situations or relationships that are not good and that continue to lead us down paths that are unrighteous? See, we have a responsibility to do that in the Lord. And I want to draw your attention to 1 John really quickly. Not everything that is said to you is truth. Can I get an amen to that? Not everything that's said from the pulpit is truth. This is why Jesus always said, hey, you want to know something? Go out and test it. Don't just believe me. Don't believe me tonight. If you're taking notes, go home and test it. If somebody gives you a prophetic word, go home and test it. Make sure that it's saturated in the Word of God, that it aligns with God's Word. See, because we're in a position no different than they were back in the New Testament, where John is writing to a lady and a church in her home, and in John chapter 1, verse 4, Beloved, do not believe every spirit. There are spirits in this land that motivate fear. There are spirits in this land called clan. There are spirits in this land that go deep. And they motivate us into division, into hatred, into you name it. Why? Because there's always a resident spirit. And Paul is saying, wait a second, or John is saying, test the spirits. Isn't that interesting? He was with Jesus for 3 years. He wrote the Gospel of John. He's been around watching Jesus do ministry continuously. Pretty much every parable that you saw, he probably was involved in some way. He calls himself the Beloved. He brags about the fact that he's the one who gets to lay on Jesus' breast. And this is the same man who's saying, wait a second, but there are resident spirits that we need to be very careful of because they cause division, they cause obstacles from us becoming the people of God that we're called to be. Test the spirits and whether they're from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you will know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. Now, the resident spirit of his day is Gnosticism, which denied Jesus in the flesh. And if Jesus did not die in the flesh, then he didn't die on the cross, did he? And everything that he did for you and I on that cross is null and void. Are there people in our society saying and opposing, saying Jesus did not die on the cross? Well, there's about how many billion Muslims that say that? And that's the reality. The denial of Jesus on the cross, the denial that he lived in the flesh, and every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says that what? If we believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, what do? We confess him. We're saved because we confess him. Every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not God. This is the spirit of Antichrist. It's not the spirit of the Antichrist, because he says in the next statement that he was coming, but he's now already in the world. So he's not Antichrist, he's a spirit of Antichrist, which means that he's opposed to who Jesus is. Are there people in your life who are opposed to who Jesus is? Are there people in your life that you know personally, they're opposed to the message that you bring to them, the life that you lead? Surrounding us all the time. Little children, you're from God. You have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. We like to say that statement a lot, don't we? But the reality behind that statement is that God is victorious in our lives. He's got the power. He's the one who is able to overcome. Why? Because he's the one who died and raised from the dead. And he's the one who's able to change a heart. You and I are just messengers. We're just ambassadors of a great king. He's the one who's able to change the heart. And if this land is going to be changed in the heart, then we need to understand something. We have to test things. Because not everything that's said is of God. Says it right here. So what do I test it against? Test it against the Word. Word of God is truth. The Word of God is able to give us, what? Understanding. It's able to shape our experiences. So if we have an experience, we can take it to the Word of God, and then we can go, ah, that was the experience I had. It's profitable for correcting and rebuking and training in righteousness. Powerful. And I love what he says here. Therefore, they speak from the world, and the world listens to them, but we are of God. If you are in this place, Christian, you are of God. If you have confessed the Lord Jesus Christ, you are of God. You have been born again into a living hope, not a dead hope. You have an inheritance reserved for you in heaven that we will attain. And God will cause us to persevere to the end because he's gracious, kind, loving, and powerful. So I don't know where you're at in your walk and what's happening right now, but let me tell you something. You have the promises of God, which are yes and amen. And the Lord's doing a work in us. And he's never going to stop doing it because he who began the good work is faithful to what? Complete it. So we don't need to sit there and wonder, oh, is God done with me? No, he's not done with you until you take your last breath and you're with him in glory. And then he's not even done with you then. I love that Paul says this and he's got the boldness. Whoever knows God listens to us. That's a pretty bold claim. Whoever has God listens to us. Whoever is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. What does that mean for us tonight? I told you it was one of those hard messages. I was like, Lord, what are we to do with this? Well, Romans is very clear at the end. It gives us a guide. And he says this, for your obedience is known to all. And he says, I rejoice over you, Roman church. I don't know what church you're from. Where are you guys all from? Where are we at tonight? Throw out some names, because I know we're not all from the same church. Elim, wonderful. Elim Arbroath. The mission, we happen to be here. Full Gospel Church. Your pastor's awesome. I love your pastor. He's great. I was with him last week. Where at? Wonderful. City Church. I know there's some Downfield Maine folk here. Woohoo! I rejoice over you. But I want you to be wise. See, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of what? Wisdom. I want you to be wise as to what is good and what is innocent, as to what is evil. I love that Paul just doesn't stop with the good, because we need to know the spirit of error and the spirit of truth. We need to understand that Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. There's no other name given amongst men by which we can be saved, redeemed, restored, retooled. And I love that Paul says this next, and I think it's so important. And this is the promise. Verse 20, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. I don't know how you feel tonight about your situation, but the promise is this, that God will crush Satan under your feet. And it's a beautiful thing because we know that Jesus stepped on the devil in the garden, did we not? He has the power, because the power that's in you is the same power that lived in him to crush Satan. Now, if we're going to take a nation for the Lord, and we're going to see it won, then we need to understand who we're fighting, why we're fighting, and who's the real power behind the army of the Lord. It's Jesus is the power. God's given us His Holy Spirit. See, we need to be approved, but we have been approved. The moment you said yes to Jesus, you were approved. We know, without a shadow of doubt, that as Paul kind of comes to the end of this letter, and he's made his way through the whole of the letter, he's basically retold the whole story of Israel so that the Roman church could actually understand. And we get to this final time, and we say, Timothy, my fellow worker, greets you. So does Lucius, so does Jason, and Sosipater, my kinsman. I, Tertius, who wrote this letter, greet you in the Lord. There's the scribe. Did you know Paul used a scribe? There's your scribe. Gaius, who is host to me and the whole church, greets you. Erastus, the city treasurer, one of our brothers, Quirinius, greets you. I want you to shout out, just shout out your names for me really quickly. Lindsay. Elizabeth, Lizzie, we greet you in the name of the Lord. Who else? Eric, we greet you in the name of the Lord. Alan, you're greeted in the name of the Lord. Margaret, you are greeted in the name of the Lord. Rob, you're greeted in the name of the Lord. Isn't this fun? Isn't this fun, guys? I was once in an African-American church in America, and it was quite fun. My friend and I were there for a whole evening, and let me tell you, the evening just kept on going and going and going. And at one point in time, we stopped in the middle, and this old woman, they started singing a song, you know, and I'm not sure if it's theologically sound, but it was good. And she said, the Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you, you know, and they got their tambourines going. And she walks right up to me and she goes, the Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. Now, I am the only other white guy in the place. And man, I've never hugged so many people in my whole life. They just kept on coming. Why? Because Paul's basically saying this, you have the power of the Lord to live out and be the church. And the question for us is, will we? Now, we all know the next kind of doxology that Paul does, the benediction in this letter. He says this, now to him who is able to strengthen you. How many of you need strength today? How many of you need strength? If you're in here and you need strength, stand up. Stand up out of the volition of your will. Stand up to the Lord. You need strength. Now to him who is able to give you strength. Let's just pray over that. Let's pray right now for strength. Lord, I pray for strength over your church in Jesus' name. I pray for strength into bodies in Jesus' name. I pray for healing in Jesus' name. We pray, Father, for mental in Jesus' name, that you would take authority over every lie of the enemy. Because you have crushed Satan under your feet, and we have crushed Satan under our feet. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would bless your church. Now, him who is able, according to the gospel and the preaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that your word is able. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's penetrative. It penetrates into bone and marrow. It separates. Lord, it allows us to walk away from those things that we don't need. That was the prayer tonight, that God would give us what we need. Lord, I pray right now that you would take that, you'd give us just what we need. And you'd give us the courage to walk away from those things that we don't need anymore. Yeah, Father, I pray right now for those who are in drug addiction. Lord, allow them to walk away right now in this city, in this town. Lord, would you take authority over those things? Would you crush that for the sake of your glory in this nation? Lord, we don't want to be known in this nation as the drug capital of Europe anymore. We make that declaration now. This is not your plan for Scotland. Lord, we take authority over the hate crime legislation, which accuses. Lord, we take authority over the right to be able to pray anywhere, even in front of an abortion clinic. Lord, this land is yours. You paid for it. You bought it. And we pray, Father, that you would do a work. Lord, we pray over the drug houses and the drug rooms, Lord. Lord, that not one young person would walk into a drug room in Jesus' name, that they would close. Lord, we pray for your church, the church of Jesus Christ. Lord, you have called us out. We are the ecclesia. The prophetic writings have been made known to all the nations. Lord, you have made it known to Scotland. You have a huge history in this land. Lord, you have done work after work after work in generation, and yet we have a generation of young people who have walked away. And we pray right now that you would bring them back. We pray right now for grandchildren to come back into the kingdom. We pray for children to come back into the kingdom. We pray for schools to have a revival. Lord, why is it that other nations can have a revival and we can't? Lord, we're asking for it. Lord, we're asking for it. We're petitioning. Lord, we repent of our sins. We repent. We say, come. We turn, Lord. We return to you. Lord, even the small group of believers, if you could do it in Rome, you could do it here. And Lord, we're praying for that right now. That you would bring about the obedience of faith. Lord, help us to be obedient, to do what you say, to go where we're supposed to go when you tell us to go there, to open our mouths when we're supposed to open our mouths, to speak truth into error. Lord, we are not called to be a people who are fearful. And I pray over fear right now in the name of Jesus over this land. I pray you break it off right now. If there are people struggling with fear in this place right now, I pray that it would be broken off in the name of Jesus. If that's you and you're struggling with fear, you struggle with fear, just be vulnerable, be honest, raise your hand to people around you. We're just going to pray right now over that. If that's you, okay, there's some people with hands up. Could you just lay hands on them right now and pray over them? Just come alongside, lay your hand on them, pray over them. Believe. Father, we pray. Lord, you didn't give us a spirit of fear. You even tell us in your word, you didn't give us a spirit of fear. But you gave us love and power and a sound mind. And I pray, Father, right now for a sound mind. A sound mind. A mind that knows between fear and courage. Lord, we pray for courage and encouragement and power. Lord, that they wouldn't just come into this meeting and leave and go, you know what, I'm fearful again. No, that it would be broken tonight. Not next week, not next year, tonight. Yeah, you are. Pour out, Lord, more of your spirit right now. Lord, I thank you that you don't call us to blame the past or make excuses. Lord, you called us a new creation. The old is gone. It's not around still. It's gone. So, Father, I pray right now over your church in this land that we would stop making excuses. No more excuses. Help us to be the people of God that you've called us to be. No more excuses. No more, well, you know, this is my life. This is who I am. No. You're not that anymore. Paul, you tell us that. You told us that. We're no longer that. Some of those things you were, but you're not those things anymore. Lord, would you help us to believe, to the obedience of faith, the obedience of faith. To the wise God. You are the King of the universe. You are the God. You can do all things. You are the wise God. There's no one like you. You are Yeshua HaMashiach. You are the Messiah. And your wisdom, Lord, I pray for a land that recognizes you as wise again. Lord, we have political parties who think they're wise in their own eyes. We have people who think they're wise in their own eyes. And yet you are the true and only wise God. So, Father, would you break right now into our society and declare yourself wise again? We depend on it. We have no wisdom in ourselves. But you are wise. And may you get the glory. May you have the Shekinah glory. May you have the glory that falls again in your temple, on your land again. And may that glory be forevermore.